So it's very important to talk, contribute to these organizations and make sure that these organizations like the American Foundation for Suicide and the Brain and Behavior Research Foundation are getting the correct funding that they need so that they can continue their research.
All right, so I know they talked about suicide prevention yesterday, but it's really such an important topic, and it has a lot to do with mental health. So I really want you guys to know and understand the warning signs and risk factors, so I'm going to go over them again. So a warning sign refers to the way that somebody acts when they're suicidal or if they're thinking about killing themselves, and it's what you need to watch out for is really what they're saying. And sometimes somebody really might just say that they want to kill themselves or that there's no point in living, but oftentimes they're more going to talk about being a burden to people or being trapped or being in a lot of pain. They're not going to be like direct about it. And then how they act, normally what happens is you'll get depressed and you'll start like pulling away from your friends and having a loss of interest in things. And then once they start thinking about suicide, if they do, they think that they kind of like found an answer and they might get happy all of a sudden. And then they might start doing risky behavior or drinking or doing drugs and then giving away prized possessions and then saying goodbyes and then actually like buying the means to carry this out. And then also with their mood, they could just be really depressed or they could be depressed and then really happy. And then rage, aggression, humiliation, and feeling anxious are all moods that go with it. And then, like they said yesterday, a common misconception is that talking about it to somebody would like plant the idea in their head, but that is not true. It actually is a really good idea if you think that somebody's thinking about it to say something to them. And then the risk factors is what like puts you at a higher risk of becoming suicidal. And a person's mental health is a major aspect in it. If they have a mental illness such as depression, bipolar disorder, or borderline personality disorder, also chronic illnesses or substance abuse plays a role in that. And then environmental factors is a death of a loved one, knowing somebody that attempted suicide, whether or not they were successful, and then long and high periods of stress, being bullied, abusive relationships, and easy access to guns and drugs. And then history just means if they've attempted or thought about suicide in the past, or if they have a family member that has tried to do it. And really just suicide is a really real and scary topic that isn't talked about enough. So as long as you are aware of the warning signs and risk factors, I think it's really like something we can prevent and we need to be more aware of.
So some current events that I found focused on new technology. One of those technologies is called Learn to Live. It's a new internet-based therapy. The president of Blue Cross Blue Shield said we're seeing engagement rates in the 30 to 50% range, which is statistically stunning. They believe the technology can help up to 75% of those affected by mental illnesses. And it's important because it's important because healthcare and insurance cost so much. They're estimated to drain about $100 billion out of our economy. The big reason that this is thought to be a success is because a lot of people don't seek like therapy is because of the stigma and they're worried what others will think of them. It's also very expensive and also having time to do it. And so with creating this technology, they've created like a cheaper way for people to do it. And also it erases the face-to-face fear that so many people with mental illnesses have. It's crucial plan considering that therapy rates are dropping super fast. Face-to-face therapy with just regular people with mental illnesses has dropped 18%. In severe mental illness cases, they've dropped by about a quarter the visits, and in even more severe, like hospital visits, have dropped by 2/3, and that's all because of the price and how much it costs for those visits. So this fall, this technology is going to be released, or this fall it was released by the University of Minnesota to over 50,000 students. So they're hoping to see good numbers from it. another new technology I found was called Virtual Psychologist. Its inventor, Dervla Laune, I don't know how to say her name, I'm sorry, hopes her invention will change the way people treat their mental health. She went and presented this to Optus and was rewarded a $72,000 grant by her success. Much like the other app that I presented, she hopes to erase the face-to-face fear that people are facing. Along with the $72,000 grant, she also entered a contest and won a $300,000 prize, along with her four other colleagues. So that just shows you how successful this app is looking. Her app, Virtual Psychologist, is online now. It's an app that you can go to. They do not have like an app on the App Store yet, but they're hoping to. And they're already seeing very positive statistics on it.
So now about survey data. So the first question that we asked UC students is, over the last 2 weeks, how often have you been bothered by feeling down, depressed, or hopeless? And we can see with the ECU data and the Minnesota data that most males said never, but ECU had less people say never and more people say 1 to 3 days. And so there was a discrepancy in that. But otherwise, it was pretty similar to the Minnesota data. And the second question that we asked was, have you ever been diagnosed with a mental illness? So these were actually quite similar to the Minnesota data, with most people saying no, but then also about five people in both saying yes. So that shows that they're pretty similar issues compared to the Minnesota. And the third question that we asked is, do you personally know anyone who's been diagnosed with a mental illness? So there wasn't Minnesota data on this, but it was really important to show the ECU data because most people, according to the survey, know someone with a mental illness, but it's a contrast to the previous slide, which showed that most people said no to them having a mental illness. So it really shows that it's prevalent in society and that many people do have these mental illnesses. And that shows that it's important to be aware of the what causes it and to be open-minded about it.
Okay, so then just a little bit more information. Some organizations is NAMI, the National Alliance on Mental Illness, and what they really try to do is educate and reduce the stigma, and they are local and national. And then Prairie Care is a local organization with 9 locations in Minnesota. And their mission statement is to providing every individual patient with the psychiatric care that they truly need. And they have support programs and services, and then they can get people hooked up with psychologists, psychiatrists, therapists, counselors, you know, whatever they need, and connect people with the resources. And then if you're like really vibing with mental health and you want to learn more on your own, I would definitely go to the National Institute of Mental Health because it just has a lot of good information, and they have obviously way more information than we could say in 40 minutes. And then U of M is actually like what Prairie Care comes from, so they just have good information as well.
So we conducted 3 interviews, and the first one was with Dr. Catherine Cullen from the U of M. She's a MD and a child and adolescent psychiatry professor there. And so she talked about 3 really major things in her interview. The first is how different ages and genders affect how mental illnesses affect one's body and their mental health, and how 10 to 20% of all adolescents will at some point feel depressed, and it's more females than males at this young age. And then the second main point that she talked about was treatments. So she gave multiple different options, the first being psychotherapy and really this counseling and therapy option, and also medications. And living a healthy lifestyle can really not be overstated, because what you do to your body really impacts your mental health. But then she also stressed that these different mental illnesses all have different ways to treat them. And the third main thing that she talked about was the stigma. She talked about how education really is one of the most important things that we can have, because most people really just are not aware about these mental illnesses. And then she also talked about how we could have something in school. Like, we could have workshops for students and parents. And we actually had one this week on Tuesday, a mental health symposium. And so things like that can really just bring the community together and inform them about mental illnesses.
So the next interview we had was with Mr. Davis. He's a counselor, one of the counselors here at UC, and also a basketball coach. And one of the major things we talked about was, what were the biggest causes in school for everyday students for depression and anxiety? And the 2 things he said were major changes in family life or school stress. So he talked about 2 major treatments that everyday people can access. First, he said support groups in school. He said that's easy for just people with similar ailments can just talk to each other, lean on like someone else's shoulder, and make everyone feel better. And next he said that because not everyone can afford to hire a therapist, he said just to schedule an appointment, come talk with one of the counselors about what you're doing in your family life, and also what's happening in school. He said talking to us or talking to the counselors is the best thing that you could possibly do. And most of these causes of depression and anxiety offered was because of a major change, so like a divorce, or maybe consistently getting bad grades in school. So just any major change is like a big cause of mental illness.
And the third interview that we did was with Miss Elizabeth Babkin. She's a parent and youth educator at NAMI, so she really goes around to different schools and different places in the community just to educate people more about it. And so she talked about two major things. First, again, the stigma, and she gave a different perspective on this. She said, "What people with cancer, we say they have cancer and they're fighting it. But people with depression, they say that they are depressed." So like they talk about how depression kind of overwhelms someone, and that negative connotation in society really just increases the stigma even more. And then the second main thing that she talked about was in-school help and how that can really be beneficial. So going back to what Sid said about how counselors can really be important, and then how these counselors can then refer to you to other programs and other organizations that can really be beneficial for you.
I know these are also the speakers in the symposium, but we actually called them separately to interview them, to clarify.
Okay, so action steps. It's really important that you're practicing good emotional hygiene and just like taking time to have a break, like a mental break. So you can do lots of things at home, which you could like color, journal, read, work out, like listen to music, whatever you want, I guess, works for you. And then also there's some cool apps that you can get, and I use all three of these. So Grid Diary is like a little journal that you can have on your phone. And then you pick the template, and then you pick what questions you want, and then you answer it every day. And then Be Okay is a breathing app. So basically you just choose how long you want to breathe in, hold it, and then breathe out. And then you record your panic attacks, which is helpful for me. And then you can set up like a speed dial. And then also I found out yesterday you can put like happy pictures, which I think is really cool. And then MoonPath asks you a set of questions 3 times a day for 14 days. And then basically it gives you like a portfolio of your mental health after 2 weeks. And then you can send it to a doctor and like write down any questions you have. And then you can also research about depression and treatment options.
So one of the biggest determinants we found that affects mental illness is actually a low income or unemployment. And because it's like a really big stressor, and this affects people everywhere. And according to Medical Daily, people who are unemployed are twice as likely to be depressed than people who are employed. And one solution we found to have is to have specialized job programs. And these job programs focus specifically on people with mental health. And some companies have actually already implemented this. And it's called supported employment. And this helps people with mental illnesses find jobs and actually keep them for a long period of time. And this program is actually not that hard to implement, especially for large companies, because they already have many programs, and this another one wouldn't be that difficult to implement, and it's already been very successful. So the next step is basically just to get large companies so more and more people can experience this.
Oh, okay, sexual orientation. So another determinant we have, so our idea was Egan does this thing called PAUSE, so it's basically like a homeroom, so we'd have 30 minutes, whether it's in the morning or in the middle of the day or at the end, where it's a study hall that pretty much everyone has, and then clubs can meet during it. But we thought it'd be really good if we had a support group that met during it, because some people aren't able to come before or after school or outside.